Following and supporting the Save Our Hospital campaign. And thank you very much for coming along to the rally today. We're going to hear from some marvellous speakers, which Derek is going to tell us about in just a tick. But before we start with the first speaker, I'm going to hand you over to Derek Robotham, who is the guardian of the Facebook page known as Town of Hartlepool Challenge. Derek.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We would appreciate if people can leave the places neat and tidy as it was when we arrived here when leaving. We've got quite a few speakers to come on, so we don't want to be hanging around too much in portraying what we're doing. The Town of Hartlepool started around about a year and 2 months ago, and since then we've got three groups in operation with over 13,000 members. So the word is spreading. We have a lot of, obviously, support from people who have problems and issues with the hospital, and we're trying our best to relate to that and try to get the hospital back. We have a lot of speakers that I've mentioned, but one in particular who is a very, very, very good friend of mine is in the audience at the moment. He's been with Save Our Hospital for 13 years. Fantastic fella. Could you please put your hands together, please, for Keith Fisher.
Good morning, Hartlepool. Can I add to that and South East Durham? I remind all of you that whenever I say us and we and whatnot, I mean Hartlepool and South East Durham. The lovely people up there have suffered at least as much as we have, and in some cases more. They have come here to Holforth Road for years. Now, out of the blue, well, it's not out of the blue, 13 years ago, we said, thanks very much for coming here. You now need to go to Stockton like the rest of us. So, if ever I just say Hartlepool, forgive me, because, you know, at least one of the people who are going to speak today is one of our original Save Our Hospital members. He's now representing Durham Miners. I am delighted to stand shoulder to shoulder with the likes of him. He's been reliable. He's always told it as it is, just as I do. Anyway, I did say good morning, Hartlepool. You now know what I mean when I say that. Here, can I say, first off, how do you follow an introduction that Derek gave you? You know, I'm humbled by the fact that he's invited me to come here and speak today. I don't have a problem with speaking, but I am conscious that often, in fact always, I say the same things, and I promise that I'm not going to go through all of those same things today, but I will say, and it's not easy to say this, I didn't organise this lovely day today. If I had, I'd arrange for it not to be drizzling with rain. But that aside, I do appreciate the work that Derek and his town of Hartlepool have done to arrange this. Can I also say that Derek knows that I was one of the few, or certainly one, who was a bit reserved about actually having it here. I wasn't happy that it was near the memorial, etc., etc. And I thought about that long and hard, and this is only my thoughts and not those of others. The people who I remembered on the placards that I can see from here all gave their all so that we could do the likes of this. They fought for our freedom. I won't forget, and I'd like to think that we are exercising that today, and I feel that they'd be watching us at least and could well be stood at our shoulders while we're doing such things. That's enough of the introduction. We'll go on to the few words I have to say to you. And unlike John Wayne, I'm going to start with an apology. Well, I'm going to start with two apologies. The first apology is that I'm sorry that it's took me 13 years and I haven't saved the hospital. Can I say when I say I, a bit like when I say Hartlepool, I mean Save Our Hospital hasn't actually saved our hospital. The mitigation to that is there are still at least two of the bricks together up there. It is still a building, it is still viable, it is still reversible, in my opinion. Yes. But it is not the hospital that we knew. You're all clapping, but it was an apology. I realise that we have failed to save it because it's in such a state now. I am here to admit that, and to admit that I always say the same things, and to apologise for that. But today, I'm going to ask you, all of you, to do something for me, for the town, and for the hospital. I'll come to that in detail in a moment. I am not an expert, but I've been doing this for a lot of years now, and in my simple terms, put the people who run the hospital, this unelected quango, in a separate group. I thought for years that we could embarrass them, we could hold it against them, the disgraceful things that they're doing. We used to keep records of all the personal disasters that families have had, and even people had died. and it just bounced off them like it would bounce off an immovable object. Quangor itself speaks for itself. They are unelected. I've called them the untouchables for years. And my advice to you is that we are past embarrassing these people. We are past, I am past keeping records of the terrible things that have happened. There are so many that I have a room full of them. They can all reduce you to tears. It is disgraceful, but they just don't care. They still keep marching on where they're going. And where they're marching on to is having houses where our hospital is and should remain. There's no doubt about that in my mind. Anyway, if you will accept that even I have realised that these people are untouchable, I then turn to the fact that perhaps our elected people, and I include all of them, whether they be councillors, whether they be MPs, I can see two of them stood in front of me, we need them to use their leverage to do something with these people. I will concentrate on the council and say I admire the fact, I applaud the fact that twice, unanimously, they have carried a vote of no confidence in the trust. In my olden days, I would see that as a first salvo to be quickly followed up by another, but there hasn't been another salvo. The other obvious salvo from my experience is that you withdraw all cooperation with these people. In my simple terms, what we have is, just across the road from me, we have a council who are saying we have no confidence in you, but I'll still work with you, I'll still allow you to operate. We need to stop these people operating. When I say we need to stop them operating, in my opinion, I'll repeat that, in my opinion, if our councillors carried another resolution which forbade any of the officers in the council to cooperate in any way with the trust, that would go to a national level immediately. It'll be another precedent. It'll be another thing peculiar to Hartlepool. Never before has there been a vote of no confidence. Certainly never before has a local authority withdrawn all cooperation with a hospital trust. I think it would disgrace them in the way that they should be disgraced, but I don't want to disgrace them because it's impossible to make them ashamed. They are shameless people, but I want to stop them working, and I do think it will. Now, as I've said to you earlier, I've only got a limited time. Don't clap or they'll pull me off. As I said to you earlier, I'm going to ask you to do something. I happen to know that perhaps down below me there's a list that has all the email addresses of all of the councillors. I want each and every one of you, and I'm looking around, I'll remember who's here. I want you all to send an email to your representative, whether it is a councillor or whether it is your MP, and say, would you support, will you propose, will you see that all cooperation is withdrawn from these people? I'll tell you now, because I have tried to move that before, we will immediately be surrounded by people who will tell you what we can't do. I've spent 13 years surrounded by people saying you can't do that. And at least there are still a few of the bricks still together at our hospital, and I do think it would have been gone if we hadn't done what you can't do. Let's go further. Let's demand that, you know, the new trust, because I think that's what we need, would reverse what's been done and bring the services back. When I go into that detail, sadly, I'm being careful not to underestimate and undermine what Derek and this meeting is about. This meeting is in Derek's intention about cooperation. I can't help but remember that a few years ago, I stood on those steps there, and there were 7 days to go before the A&E closed, and I was the only one that spoke. I don't have a problem with that, but I was. If you have a look at how many people speak in a day, there must be something different today. And I'm sure that they'll explain to us what it is. But I rather think some of it has to do with the fact that there's an election coming. It might just be the sad way that my mind works, but I am entitled to my opinion, and the fact that people who I don't even know are here speaking today must mean something. I will applaud and thank anyone who tries to help, but I won't be used to do that. Can I also say that it is important that it is no good the likes of me or the likes of one of your councillors or your MP speaking. We all need to speak, and I'd like you to all speak by, as I say, demanding. When I say, the last time I spoke there was 7 days before the closure of the A&E, I distinctly remember standing there and in my audacity I said, my God created all of this in 7 days, so surely we can save an A&E in 7 days. Well, me speaking to you as a voter and as one of you voters, there are about 90 days to go off to the next election. This is the time that we have all the cards, we have all the numbers, we have all the powers. Please use it. Please let these people know that you're going to measure them by what they do between now and May, and not what they promise to do after May and the likes of that. I've got a shed full of promises, I've got a shed full of lies, I've got a shed full of support that never existed. I need something solid. I need something to stop the trust from working. I'm conscious that I've spoken longer than I was intending to speak and longer than Derek will be comfortable with. But can I first thank you all for attending, and can I say that I'm going to come down there and listen carefully to what other people are telling me and promising me. But the truth is, the fact that you are here says it all, and I do applaud that, and I thank you very much. Thank you.
Ladies and gents, Guardian Mr. Kingfisher. Okay, ladies and gents, on to the next speaker for this morning. I'd like to introduce Councillor David Riddle from Putting Harpagull First, the Independent Party.
Sorry, it was just something mentioned to Mr. Fisher, which I'll get to in a moment. I'm not here really to talk to you as a councillor today. I'm here to talk to you as a dad, as a father. Because 11 months ago, my wife gave birth to our first child, my baby son, Ethan. And I was so blessed. He has the biggest brown eyes, he's got beautiful blonde hair. And that day that he was born, you know, I can assure you, it was the happiest day of my life. And before he was born, we went several times to that maternity unit at Hartlepool Hospital, and we looked around it there, and it is fantastic. We were there talking to the nurses, talking to the midwives, looking at the facilities. And my wife, you know, she wanted to try a water birth. They've got a birthing pool. They even have a room where you can stay the night as a dad and make sure you're there in the morning to be right there with your newborn child. And that's what we were going to do. My little boy, he was going to be born at Hartlepool like I was, and my dad was, and my granddad was. And then we found out something else from the nurse. We found out that if there was any problem at all, any complication during that birth of my little boy, that there was no doctor available to help. There would be no doctor in a hospital. And we scratched our heads about that and we listened. And the nurse, and I don't blame the nurse because they do a fantastic job, she was only doing what she was told. She said to us, in the event of any serious problem with my wife or my little boy, you will be, quote, whizzed across in an ambulance to North Tees. You know, whizzed across to North Tees in an ambulance, like it's just down the corridor. And any of you that work out the town, you know that there's the flyover, there's the traffic. You know, so she's saying to us, make a choice here, make a choice. North Tees or Hartlepool. Now, a choice to me, it's like, do you want a cup of tea or do you want a cup of coffee? do you want Chinese takeaway or do you want pizza? The choice is not, do you want to run the risk of your wife and little boy dying in an ambulance? Or should we just take you to North Tees? Now, that's not a choice. So I can assure you, we're here and I'm supporting Mr. Fisher. I'm not up for election for 4 years. I don't care about votes. I say what I think, I say what I think's right. And this is the right thing to do. So, in a nutshell, the situation that we've arrived at over those years that Mr. Fisher talks about, and this is where we are now. Just think on this. This hospital trust are making it impossible to be born in Hartlepool, but they are making it very, very easy to die in Hartlepool. And that is the reason we need to stop this. Now, I mentioned to Mr. Fisher there, I can save you the trouble of the emails to your councillors regarding withdrawal from the trust. There's a meeting this Monday, a full extraordinary council meeting, Monday the 16th, and I will propose in that meeting, hand on heart, that we pull out of that trust and absolutely withdraw from it. And you can then see with your own eyes which councillors actually agree. Thank you for listening. Keep fighting. We will not give up. Thank you.
Ladies and gents, proud dad, David Riddle. I can introduce to you a local organisation, really, very much on our doorstep at Darlington, stopped through at Darlington, and it's went national very much now. It's the 999 call for the NHS. I'd like to introduce to you Barbara.
Hello everybody. I'm going to try and follow on from Keith and David there, which is quite hard. First of all, I'd like to wish you all a happy Valentine's Day. We're here today not just to fight for hospital and our hospital services, but actually to show how much we love them. 999 is a national organisation. As David said, the gentleman said there, it started in Darlington, but it's actually become a national organisation. It's the organisation that organised the March for the NHS last year. We visited 23 towns and cities on our march from Jarrow down to London. And I'd like to share with you why I joined the March for the NHS and why I've come to join with you here today. I was born in the NHS. My mum was a home help and my dad was a boiler maker. I didn't grow up in Hartlepool, you can probably tell from where I talk. I grew up on Merseyside. But my mum and dad worked hard, and when they died, they couldn't leave me loads of money and they couldn't leave me loads of property. But what they did leave me was they left things that had been fought for hard by the unions and by collective action. They left things like the Health and Safety at Work Act and the Equalities Act. And most preciously of all, they left the NHS. And I want to be able to leave that NHS to my children and my grandchildren. So I'm here today to stand with the people of Hartlepool and to stand with people all across the country to say this is our NHS. It doesn't belong to big business. It's not the government's to sell. It's our NHS and we're going to keep it. Yay! I'm no politician and I'm not looking for votes. And what I'd like to say to all the politicians who are here and who you're going to be hearing from today is no matter who gets elected, no matter what promises you make to us, no matter what form of government it is, what kind of coalition it is, organisations like Save Hartlepool Hospital and 999 for the NHS will be there after the elections, and we'll still be there saying it's our NHS, you can't sell it off. We're going to keep it, and we will be there every step of the way, and we will be on top of that government until they stop selling the NHS to private companies, to their mates and their cronies to make a profit from. I work in the NHS. I've got lots of reasons to love the NHS. I'm going to be having my picture taken lots of times today. Inside a heart saying I love the NHS. And we're going to be tweeting those pictures nationally to show everybody across the country how much people in Hartlepool care and how hard they're going to fight for their hospital. I've lost track of what I'm supposed to be saying, so just bear with me. Like I said, I work in the NHS and my daughter works in the NHS. And what I want to do is make sure I leave an NHS where we can give care to everybody. We don't have to check how much money people have got when they come into hospital. We don't have to check that they can settle the bill. We don't have to worry that if we give people expensive treatments that they're going to end up in debt. They're going to have bailiffs banging on the door because somebody's coming after them to pay the bill. That's not the kind of country I intend to live in. So I'm going to stand shoulder to shoulder with everybody here today and fight to save Hartlepool Hospital and join in nationally with all the other campaigns from people who are fighting to save their local hospitals. I'd like to leave you with some words. I've got them printed on the back of my T-shirt. It came from an Iron Bevan, and an Iron Bevan said, "The NHS will last as long as there are people with the faith to fight for it." What I want to say is you're the folk with the fight. No, you're the folk with the faith. And we're all going to carry on fighting. I'm going to fight as hard as I can, and I hope you're all going to join me. Thank you.
Ladies and gents, Barbara from the 999 call for the NHS. Ladies and gents, without further ado, if I could introduce you to Hartlepool MP, Mr. Ian Wright.
Thank you, Jason. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. May I thank the organisers of the event. May I thank the opportunity to be able to speak and to allow others to speak. But most of all, may I thank you. On a cold and drizzly Valentine's Day, you're showing the strength of feeling that you've got for the National Health Service. And there are a number of reasons for that. I think everybody here will have relied, like I have, on the National Health Service. The National Health Service is the pride of Britain and the envy of the world. And the reason why is because it's your NHS. It's our NHS. And I think we do need you to fight now more than ever. I think it's in danger now, for more than it's been for more than 70 years of its existence, in respect of being broken up, run down and sold off. It's your NHS, it's paid for by general taxation, not by private medical insurers, and it's owned by all of us, not private companies. Now, let me tell you about Hartlepool Hospital. Winning it is not going to happen. North Tees is inappropriate and inaccessible. North Tees cannot be the single site hospital for our area. And on that basis, services need to return back to Hartlepool. There needs to be a vibrant, full service of hospital provision here in our town. Now, in 10 days' time, I'm meeting, along with some representatives from Hartlepool Borough Council, with Jeremy Hunt, the Secretary of State for Health. I'm going to say to him how important it is that services are returned. I'm going to say to him the strength of feeling that we have here in Hartlepool and South East Durham. And I'm going to say that the trust, North Tees and Hartlepool NHS Trust, have to listen to the people of Hartlepool. So far, they haven't. And if the Trust don't listen, the Trust has to change. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you for showing the strength of feeling of how much you love the NHS. And hopefully, we can make sure that the Trust does listen when we have services back here in Hartlepool. Thank you.
Gents, Ian Wright, the MP for Hartlepool. All right, cracking up. I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Richard Royal, who is the Conservative Party's prospective parliamentary candidate. Richard.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Happy Valentine's Day to you. Firstly, I want to thank the organisers of today's event for putting this all together, for getting such a great range of speakers along. And for ensuring that hopefully it's conducted in the right manner. Now, I'm not here today to try to score party political points. And I'm not here today to try to suggest that any of the other candidates don't care or aren't passionate about this issue. nor am I here to try to hijack a campaign that all of you have been working on and fighting for many, many years. What I am here to do is to give you my support for keeping hospital services in Hartlepool. Now, my mum is in the crowd somewhere today, and I won't embarrass her by pointing her out, even if I could see her. But she works at a hospital just down the coast from here that has been experiencing many of the same issues for a decade or more. And she's been at many similar events to this, and she and I joined many of you on the march last month. And we did that because we support the cause, because we have personal experience of it, and because we recognise what it means. You don't have to necessarily be a so-called local lad to see a problem and to want to fix it. I fundamentally believe that a town the size of Hartlepool needs and deserves a hospital. And I fundamentally believe that it needs an A&E. And I believe that in an ideal world that needs to be at its centre, not on the outskirts and not in another town. The very purpose of an A&E unit is for it to be accessible to people in an emergency. And that means that it needs to be close to the people that it serves. And a bad location can be a matter of life or death. In fact, one study showed that for every 6 miles you have to travel to an A&E unit, an extra 1% of people died as a result. So for every 100 people who need emergency services here in Hartlepool and have to travel to Stockton, on average 2 of them will die as a result of that decision. And if this campaign can help to save those 2 lives, then it's worth its weight in gold. Now, I do think that the financial case for the original Wynyard project was questionable. I do think that Ian Wright and many others were wrong to promise so much of your money on decisions that you oppose. I do think that it was short-sighted to take hospital services away from Hartlepool Hospital on the presumption that a scheme like that could go ahead at a time of national crisis. But the problem is that those in power here have a cavalier attitude to spending other people's money. Their solution to a problem is never just to fix that problem, it's always to spend mountains of cash creating another problem somewhere else. But they don't have that money to spend, because it's either your money which should be in your pocket, or it's borrowed money that has to be paid back at extortionate levels of interest. Now, we've just come out of one of the major recessions that this country has ever known. It is absolutely right that we should question whether that kind of money is being promised irresponsibly. Now, by all means, ask if what we've got at the moment is fit for purpose and needs improving. But let's fix those problems rather than selling people down the river on a pipe dream. Now, today you'll hear a lot of people talking about government cuts in healthcare and privatisation. Don't believe it. The NHS budget was not only ring-fenced, but increased by the Conservatives. Healthcare has been increased by £13 billion since 2010. There are now 600 more doctors and 250 more nurses right here in the North East than there were 5 years ago. And nationally, there are now 1,200 more A&E doctors able to see 2,000 more patients each and every single day. Now, it's very easy, but very lazy to try to blame these kind of problems on some far distant external enemy. People can say it's government cuts, or it's immigrants, or it's Europe. It's not. It's people making promises that they can't deliver. So let's learn to walk before we can run. Let's learn to spend other people's money more wisely. And let's tell the people in power here, both today and at the ballot box in May, that Hartlepool needs and deserves its hospital services. Have a fantastic Valentine's Day. Thank you.
Oh, and the Tories have won that.
Save Our Hospital Valentine's Day rally, I would like to introduce to you now Philip Broughton from UKIP, the prospective parliamentary candidate. Philip.
Thank you very much, Jason, and thank you to everyone, and it's great to see so many people here today. I think it's very clear, you know, that the Hartlepool Hospital is the biggest issue facing Hartlepool, and there are several issues I think we need to resolve. First, We need to stop this nonsense idea of regionalising and centralising health services. We need local services at the local hospital that are accessible to all residents. Second, we need democratic accountability. Mr. Fisher was talking earlier on and I couldn't agree more with him. We've got to make sure we've got democratic accountability in decision making. I believe if we bring in locally elected health boards, we would never have these kind of problems ever again. You would have elected people who understand the situation on the ground, held accountable by the ballot box. Instead, at the moment, we have health boards selecting people who are unaccountable to local people's views. Third, the issue of the Wynyard Hospital. The Wynyard Hospital is never going to happen, and everybody knows it. It is pie in the sky thinking. The Health Trust are clearly out of touch with public opinion. People don't want a new hospital, they want to keep their existing hospital. The Wynyard Hospital will not work on three grounds. Number one, the travel issues and costs for both the NHS and the people of Hartlepool are unacceptable. Second, the traffic on the A19 will make it extremely difficult for someone in a life and death situation in an ambulance to get to North Tees or the James Cook Hospital. Frankly, the possibilities don't bear thinking about. Finally, it is the wish of the people of Hartlepool, and they must not be ignored, to have their own hospital. We all love the NHS. It is our greatest institution, and we must protect it. We stand here today, united to send a loud and clear message to the decision makers at the top. And I now call on Alan Foster and the Health Trust to stop burying their heads in the sand, scrap the Wynyard project, and return to the people of Hartlepool a fully functioning hospital with all the services. Thank you. Thank you.
Ladies and gents, Philip Rohn from UKIP, the prospective parliamentary candidate for Hartlepool as well. The next person I'd like to introduce is from the Green Party, again the prospective parliamentary candidate for Hartlepool, Mr. Michael Holmes. Michael.
Hi, I feel like Evita up here. Right. So, promises. Oh, thank you very much. Promises are an important thing in politics. When you think about Nick Clegg, the first thing you think about is tuition fees. That pledge is going to follow him to his grave. What I don't understand is why the same doesn't apply to David Cameron. You shouldn't be able to think David Cameron without thinking NHS privatisation. He didn't just sign a little pledge. The Tories spent hundreds of thousands of pounds on a billboard campaign up and down the country with David Cameron's airbrushed egghead saying, "I'll cut the deficit, not the NHS. No more top-down reorganisation." Pretty much straight away he gets into power and he slashes the NHS across the throat. It was nowhere in the Tory manifesto, it was nowhere in the Lib Dem manifesto. They had no mandate to privatise our NHS. The NHS is Britain's greatest achievement. Just think about how elitist our society would be, how elitist our society is becoming now. Just imagine how elitist it would be if we didn't have it. It's scary stuff. Why do we have the NHS in the first place? Look at the monument. We're only allowed to have the NHS because of the terrible sacrifices that the British people made during two world wars. The people who survived that period wanted to build a better world out of the rubble. I remember David Cameron rocking up to the cenotaph on Remembrance Sunday, solemnly faced, talking about how much he valued the sacrifice those soldiers made. If he genuinely respected the sacrifice they made, he wouldn't be destroying the institution they fought and died for. When you think David Cameron, you should think NHS privatisation, NHS privatisation, NHS privatisation. I believe we need to take responsibility for our society and our country again. I went to a meeting with members of the NHS Trust this week. I know Foster and Garvin don't do themselves any favours, but the truth is they're not actually in control of the situation. The decision about the future of the NHS in Hartlepool isn't being made till after May. because it's totally in the hands of the British public and the government they choose to elect. We need to expand the scope of what is possible with our NHS. We need to give our brilliant staff the breathing room they need to save the service from dying. I'm standing for the Green Party. I'm sure many of you think the Greens are just a bunch of tree huggers and wacky-backy smokers. You'd only be half right. The fact is, the reason I support the Greens is because they have the strongest commitment to the NHS of any of the parties. We want a full, publicly run and funded service, no privatisation, no marketisation, no compromise. We are a wealthy country. If the rich paid their taxes, we could afford the service we need. We paid out £1 trillion in state welfare when the banks tanked our economy in 2008. To put that into perspective, we could have built Wynyard Hospital 3,846 times over for that price. The second their backers in the city run into trouble, money is no object, while politicians gamble with the lives of people from Hartlepool as we wait years and years for a hospital that we are told we can't afford. That's what pisses me off the most about UKIP. They tell us all our problems with the NHS are caused by immigrants and that we can't afford it and we need to move to private insurance, while Nigel Farage has big dinners with his banker mates in the city to fund his campaign. I am proud that NHS campaigners, like all of you, up and down the country, forced UKIP into changing their stance on the NHS. They knew they would be unelectable if they went into the election praising privatisation. I would just like to say to Nigel, do you think we're stupid? We know that you'd throw the NHS under the bus in a heartbeat if it meant UKIP could get into a coalition with the Tories. Whatever your preconception about the Green Party, don't just go off what the media's told you. Go to the website and read our policies on the NHS. If you believe we need to reinstate the NHS, get tax avoiding companies and individuals to pay their fair share, and keep the NHS out of the EU trade deal TTIP that would make reversing NHS privatisation illegal, then please get involved with the Greens. We need all the support we can get. Help to make us the opposition party that this town sorely needs. Thanks very much. Save our hospital and the NHS.
Ladies and gents, I've just got to say the one and only Green Party representative, Mr. Michael Holt. Ladies and gents, our next speaker is a local lad, a local cabbie, a charity worker as well. And he's been involved in the Save Our Hospital campaign for around about 2 years now. So he's not just on the bandwagon, he's been in it for quite a while. Without further ado, ladies and gents, prospective parliament candidate, Mr. Stephen Pinkton.
Just start off by saying a huge thank you, and this is for our nurses, our doctors and the emergency services at North Tees who are working under pressure. They're doing a fantastic job and nobody thanks them people at all. They're stressed out every single day, and when you see a programme on Panorama where a nurse wants to walk out halfway through the shift, there is something wrong. I just want you to put our hands together, please, for these people. Nobody's thanking them. They're under stress. We need them. We're fighting for them. They're not giving up, nor should us. Behind you there, we have our council officers, and we have a ceremonial mayor. Now, he was the chair of health scrutiny. He rubber-stamped the closure of the A&E. He was elected by a Labour council. Now they're telling us they want it back. Same with Ian Wright. He stood in front of us 10 years ago. This hospital would not close while I'm in charge. What's happened? What's happened, Ian? Where have you gone? There you go. What's happened? You lied. You lied to every single person here. You have. You sat in that digger up at Wynyard with a cheesy grin on your face. Now you're saying it's not going ahead. It's in all the papers. There's five of us here that's running for the MP of Hartlepool. Two of them, I know for a fact, if they don't win, they're going to go back to where they live. They're not going to be fighting for this hospital. People like me and people like Michael have been on this campaign from day one. It's us that's fighting the fight, not them. They're going to go home. They're not going to care what's happened to us. I don't follow no party lines. I am independent. I don't answer to anybody. I answer to you, the people of Hartlepool. We want our hospital back. We want it now. Next week, next year, we just want it back, yeah?
So we've got our partners here today from the Durham Miners. We've got Barry Chambers. Here he is, Barry Chambers, ladies and gents.
Good morning, everybody. Keith Fisher said this morning when he made his address first that the people of the colliers, and what he means is the colliers, he means Blackhall, Horton, Easenden, Wingate, the people close to Hartlepool, that's always looked at Hartlepool for services. And he said that we've stood by the Save Our Hospital campaign since its concept 13, 14 years ago. Now, I'm so much behind the Save Our Hospital campaign, I just came here automatically this morning. But although I'm a Connery lad, I'm also a Hartlepool through and through. I came down here today to go to see my beloved football club, Hartlepool United. I can tell you now, I did not know I was going to speak here today. I've just been invited to get up, so I'll just speak as I see it from my point of view. I've been to nearly every meeting in the council offices, in the town hall theatre, in the various community centres in Hartlepool, at Bellevue and Westview and everything, for years and years, going back to the time of Russell Hart, etc. And you can't seem to get through to the people that runs the NHS the difference between a general hospital and a super hospital like James Cook. My grandparents lived in Blackhall, and one of them had the appendix took out in Hartlepool in the 1940s at a general hospital. We've always gone for specialist treatment to Newcastle, Sunderland, York even, London, for specialist treatment. But to go for general hospital treatment to Stockton, if my grandparent could get the appendix took out at Hartlepool in the 1940s, if my grandchild had its appendix took out now, the Ben would have to go on to stop him. Is that progress? No. I've been to meetings where we tried to force the hand of the council. We got it to the point where they even appointed a Professor Darzai to make a study which cost hundreds of thousands of pounds to the viability of Hartlepool and North Tees Hospital. And the result of his analysis and research was that one hospital could not work and Hartlepool Hospital must be maintained. And what did they do? They had a reconfiguration committee, the first time I'd ever heard of the word, and they changed everything upside down. And it's like everything else where you get mergers. One place gets merged and the other gets submerged. And Hartlepool Hospital has certainly been submerged in this merger. We took part in collecting a petition that got 34,000 signatures. And we stopped at 34,000 because we could have gone further. And what was done with that? It was taken to Sedgefield, and Mr. Blair didn't even have the decency to come out and receive it. Somebody took it on his behalf because he was meeting some travellers or something at the time about a much more important matter. That's what happened to our 34,000 signature petition. The Blackhall Labour Party, which I'm the chairman of, gave £350 to Merton Connery Band to come down here. We organised a march around this town and we gave half of our local fund to the band to come down here, and it was stopped the night before by the chief of police on safety grounds. Yet we can still allow the ADL to march in Hartlepool, and our march was stopped. We've had votes of no confidence by the council in the trust, taken no notice of. I was advised at the public meeting in the town hall theatre a few weeks ago not to say what I was going to say. And I'm not despairing with the attempts to get rid of Foster and Garvin. I got up and said the only way we'd get rid of them was to have them assassinated. So I was advised not to say it there because I was told I would be arrested. Well, I've said it here. We've had meetings in the colliery areas, one at Easington just a few weeks ago, and a very unique meeting. It's the first meeting I've ever attended with Keith Fisher present where he didn't speak. He said to me, I'm in your area now, buddy, you get on with it. And I'll tell you, the people of Easington gave Garvin and Foster a real rough ride. But the one thing that came out of it that really disturbed me was after the meeting, he talked to an old chap who'd been given a bit of trouble through the meeting, and he said, I have no trouble with Hartlepool Council. There's quite a few councillors agree with what I say, but they won't say it in public. Now that's the sort of thing we've got to watch. Betrayal. We've got to watch that. Now, all I can say, we've done everything we can, and I'm just speaking on spur here now. I hope we win this battle. We've got to win this battle for the future of this town, because we've got a battle on up the road, an Old Kim Football League team. We didn't want to be losing our hospital and everything, otherwise we go to bum and vanish off the map, this town. And it's up to the elected, and I'm looking at Ian right now, it's up to the elected officials, the MP and the council. Unfortunately, the Easington District Council of late hasn't took such a great part in the Save Our Hospital campaign, because it was dismantled and drafted into the Greater County, Durham County Council. And now Easington is only a corner of Durham County Council. Against the wishes of 80% of the people, there was a ballot carried out who didn't want to go into County Durham. And that's why, if Easington District Council had still been here and hadn't been amalgamated forcefully with seven other district councils, there would have been two councils fighting all the time, rather than us having to beg on for Hartlepool Council to do it. So I thank you all for attending today. I hope we win the fight, and I hope we win the match this afternoon.
Mr. Barry Chambers, a very, very shy and reserved individual, I think. The Teesside People's Assembly introduced to you Mr. Steve Cook. Steve.
Hi. I wouldn't say I was non-political. Are you cold? Me too. Our NHS was created in 1948 by those who knew what it was like to live in a society without a proper, publicly funded health service. And now it's being undermined. The two parties in the coalition government, as people have said already, they never had this in their programmes, in their manifestos. It wasn't in their coalition agreement. But they've introduced huge changes to the Health and Social Care Act in 2012. Did you know that the Act of Parliament abolished the Secretary of State's duty to provide a comprehensive health care service? He no longer has that duty. Apparently, it's not the government's duty to provide an NHS now. In Hartlepool or in any other the other towns and cities that are taking part in this Love NHS Day of Action. It's also accelerated billions of pounds of contracts for NHS work being put out to tender. Most of those contracts are going to companies set up to make a profit, like Virgin Healthcare, Serco, Care UK and Circle. The government say they're making the service more efficient, getting rid of waste and bureaucracy. But in reality, they're just shaping those services up to make them more attractive for privatisation. NHS workers' terms and conditions and wages are being attacked, so there'll be a cheaper workforce. The NHS has been split up into different business units, so it's more difficult for people to organise collectively to challenge what's happening. Oh, and locally we've been told that the clinicians, they don't want to work at Hartlepool Hospital because they don't get a wide enough range of experience. Why is that, I wonder? Because they've actually withdrawn services. So that's them trying to make lay facts on the ground. They're kind of trying to justify what they want to do next. One service is taken away, which makes another service no longer viable. So then they say, oh, we'll have to take that away as well. But it's not just about Hartlepool Hospital. The same thing's happening elsewhere in the country. And it's not just the NHS. Vulnerable people are being put at risk by cuts throughout our public services. When you come out of hospital now, your recovery will be made more difficult because the follow-up support services have been cut too. Home visits by carers will be shorter and they're less frequent. And that's because of the cuts that are happening all around. The grants that you might have got to help you live independently, to adapt your home for your disability, many of them have been abolished. And we're told these cuts are necessary because of the government debt. How was that debt created? It was created by the same people the government is now awarding these contracts. Did you know the wealth of the richest 1,000 people in this country is doubled since the financial crash? Well, what's happened to our wages? The rest of us have experienced declining living standards and higher bills. Teesside People's Assembly, well, we're not non-political. We are political. We're not party political. We're part of a nationwide campaign campaigning against the austerity cuts. And whoever wins in May, we'll be there to hold them accountable. And I hope you'll be there too. We're organising campaigns, not just on NHS, but on local authority cuts and cuts to all public services. Save Hartlepool Hospital.
Mr. Steve Cook. Well done there, Steve. All right, ladies and gents, I'm going to introduce to you our second MP of the day. This is Mr. Graham Morris, the MP for Easington. Graham.
Thanks. Can you hear me? Excellent. It's a great pleasure to be here, and thank you very much for inviting me. And it's a great pleasure to be following Barry Chambers, who I know has been an absolute stalwart of the campaign. I bring greetings here from East Durham. I'm proud to represent the communities of Easington, Horden, Blackhall, and those in South East Durham who look to Hartlepool for hospital services. It's Valentine's Day, and it's a day traditionally that we spend with our loved ones, and we express the love to the institutions and the people that we care about. There's no greater love for any institution than the love that we all share for our National Health Service. Now, I know various speakers have come up here and made political pitches. Some have said they're not political. Well, I'm afraid I am. I'm a Labour MP. I'm proud of it. I'm a lifelong campaigner for the NHS. I worked in it. I bring regards and felicitations from my union, Unite. I also wish to express my pride and appreciation for the work that's carried out by the people who work in our National Health Service in Hartlepool and throughout the country. We owe them a great debt of honour. I also want to say how proud I was to be with the Jarrow marches and the 999 march for the NHS. The people who were walking in the footsteps of giants from Jarrow all the way to London. I didn't walk all the way. I saw them off from Jarrow and I walked the last mile from Holborn to Trafalgar Square. But it was a great honour to see those huge crowds. And it's testament to the high regard that the public have for our beloved National Health Service. And when we hear Conservative politicians saying that we have to be frugal, that we can't afford the best hospital care for our people here in the North East, well, I'm afraid they're absolutely wrong. Because there are £70 billion in uncollected taxes. There are incredibly rich individuals and corporate entities who have paid no tax at all and employ expensive tax avoidance methods in order to deprive the Exchequer of money that could otherwise fund our public services. The questions that I ask in Parliament about health inequalities, about cancer services, about how we adequately resource and recruit GPs. It's down to a large degree to resources, but it's down to political will too. If we have the political will to spend £100 billion on the Trident submarine system, why can't we find the millions necessary to provide decent quality care for people here in Hartlepool and in East Durham? And the answer is, if there's a will, there's a way. And the truth is, the only way we're going to get that is if Ed Miliband is in Downing Street. Now I tip my cap to the Greens and to all the progressives who are out there campaigning on left-wing platforms. But the truth is, we must have a Labour government if we're going to reverse these cuts. And the Tories will tell you that there's more money going in the health service. Well, that may be true. But there's £3.5 billion that have been transferred into social care because councils like that one have had 40% cut from their budgets and they've had to denude local government services in order to balance the books. So I'm under no illusions about the way forward. And in relation to Hartlepool Hospital, let me just say, because I know time's short and you've been very patient, but I want to say a few things about Hartlepool. What we've seen is a gradual salami slicing of services transferred from Hartlepool to North Tees and further afield. And that more disadvantages my people, Barry, Myrtle, June and all the others from East Durham who are here, than anybody from Hartlepool because of the travelling distances involved. And to me, I think it's an absolute outrage that having been promised a brand new state-of-the-art facility, we're now looking at a botched compromise of a transfer of services bit by bit to North Tees. It's not acceptable. I don't support that. The policy of my constituency party from day one has been to resist that, and I reaffirm that. We're at a crossroads. You know, the Momentum programme, that's a Hartlepool-based programme, hasn't delivered the promised new hospital. And in the circumstances, we really must begin the process of returning services to Hartlepool, including having the necessary funding, both capital and revenue, to achieve that. Thank you very much for your patience. I commit myself to that completely and unreservedly. And I just say, thank you for showing the love for our health service. Thank you for your support for the hospital and for the people who work in it. Thank you very much and have a happy Valentine's Day. God bless you all.
The MP for East England, Mr. Graham Morris. We've got somebody who's going to be speaking very, very shortly on his story. A Hartlepoolian, a man from the town, would like to share his story with you. Ladies and gents, if I could introduce Mr. Carl Robertson. Carl.
Good afternoon, ladies and gents. Before I start, can I just thank you all for being very patient with us today? And if you could all remain with us for another 10 minutes approximately until we finish, it would be greatly appreciated from all the organisers of this event today.
After I'd returned home, I had to have my son taken to a hospital. I thought it would be a local hospital to see a doctor right on our doorstep. This was not the case. I had to come all the way back from North Tees Hospital from visiting my grandfather with cancer to take my 17-month-old child to North Tees Hospital to be seen by a consultant. This is because I was informed by health visitors that we did not have a doctor in Hartlepool Hospital that could see my child in the children's day unit. I call upon all councillors, prospective politicians and our current MP to return the services to our hospital. You have robbed Hartlepool of their health services. Ian Wright, you have been proven to be digging holes that Winnie had in a digger. Labour government is not needed in this town. Get a taxi for Ian. We ain't going to get our hospital back if that man is in power another 5 years. Vote and make your feelings known at the ballot box when it comes to May the 7th. Thank you all for listening.
Save Our Hospital, a Valentine's Day rally is almost at an end. What I want you to make sure that you've done before you go today is to make sure that we have your signature on this board in front of the podium down here. Okay. And I would like to say that being from 102.4 Radio Hartlepool, we support our listeners and we support you in your cause to save our hospital. Without further ado, ladies and gents, to close today's gathering off, I'll introduce to you Michelle. Over to you, Michelle.
Hi everyone. I'd just like to say a massive thank you to everybody who's turned up today, to all our supporters, to all the parliamentary candidates and to all the speakers. A massive thanks to Keith Fisher, because without him we wouldn't be here today. I'm admin on the Town of Hartlepool Challenge page, and what we believe is we need our hospital back. We need it fully functioning and back to the 5-star rating it previously had. I'm not a speaker, I've never done this before, but what I do believe in is that with people power can make a difference. We all need our hospital for one reason or another. We've seen people really suffering with the loss of our hospital. Today, we've achieved something with all these people here, and I personally want to thank every single one of you. Also, a massive thanks to Middleton Grange for allowing us to stand here on their property and proceed with this event today. It hasn't been easy to organise, but it's not the last. We will be making a difference and we will be carrying on this fight. This is not the last you will hear of us. So without further ado, I would just like to thank you all and have a big round of applause for all the stewards, everyone who's taken part, and a round of applause for yourself because you've stood for so long and it's not the best of days, is it? Thank you very much and I hope to see you all at the next event.
Ladies and gents, for Save Our Hospital 2015, three cheers. Hip hip. Hooray! Hip hip.
Hooray!
Hip hip.
Hooray!
Thank you.